I also don't stand too much on ceremony, but I think I need to acknowledge the presence of all the dignitaries who are here, and Akores, non-Akores, invited guests, everyone who is here for us to share in a conversation on how we can make sports in Ghana a source of comparative advantage. I'd like to welcome all of you. I'd like to welcome the Die Hard Supporters Union. They've been with me since 2005, when we brokered the sponsorship. I'm also not good at reading speeches, but I'll try and stick to some part of the script. When I think it's getting too dreary, I wrote it myself. I know what is inside. I'll see what is inside. And then the media men can take it and go and do their stories. I think it's a fair way to start. Thank you very much for the honor done me. And 1987, Akora, Evan Sanfom said it. Sometimes when I'm with the older ones, I feel like a small boy. When I'm with the younger ones, I feel like an old man. But Achimota School did a lot for us in terms of sports. Think about a 13-year-old young man who starts balding as a Form 3 student in Agri House. That was my story. And that's why I'm so passionate about sports. Because at the age of 13, when I comb my hair forward, it goes backwards. And all my friends were cutting nicely shaped. You know, at the time they called it punk or something. You know, it's all like a table. And then it combs the hair and then it goes backwards. It goes backward. I use several lotions. Every birthday, I was being given certain hair growth lotions. I was struggling to accept it. It was tough. Imagine you guys, all of you, nice heads of hair. I wasn't blessed with that. So I needed to find a way for definition and to build my confidence. And I was torn between becoming a cadet and being a sportsman. So I started with the cadet. The discipline was too much. By the third week, they took us to some camp at Petway. You wake up in the morning with boots, go and walk in a marshy area. You come back in the evening, the same boot, you must take it off, clean it, polish and shine. One set of fatigues, as in the green. You need to clean it up, iron it, and get ready for parade the next morning. By the third week of the camp, I was out of the place. So the next option was sports. Little knowing that that choice will become the area of national life that would define the balding 13-year-old guy. I used to skip music classes. Mr. Ken Kafu is here, he's a witness. Well, there were two classes I didn't like, music and French. So music class, I won't go. Then Mr. Hansen Bright would mark me absent. And in Form 2, I made the mistake of going to run 800 meters without preparing properly. And I came last, and Hansen Wright was running commentary. There comes Mortagbe, the perennial skipper of music class. He is last. He will be last. Anyone who skips music class will be last. The guy dealt with me big time. But I vowed that from 3, at the time it was 1 to 3, and then 4 to upper 6, junior boys, senior boys. Now we have from 1 to 3, is that right? Or they are thinking of doing for four years now? Whatever happens, it's still Ghana. We'll see how it goes. In Form 3, I ran the same 800 meters race, and I came first. And in Form 4, I ran 5,000 meters, 12 and a half rounds, and I came first. And because of the configuration of my head that I couldn't accept, I started getting fans. Yeah, but if you're a school champion, you'll get fans. And then the ladies who I couldn't speak with confidence, based upon becoming a school champion, there was beginning to get some access. This is sports for sports. And then from 5, because the fans for 5,000 was not too much, I decided to drop in the duration or the length of race. So I went to 400 meters. I came third, and then we went to stadium 4 by 400 meters. And our headmaster at the time, RWSA, who also called Bob Satan. Sorry, this is what we used to call him, Bob Say. The Say is Satan. But it had to stop at Say. He dealt with us in 4-5. Half of my generation of 4-5 boys went on one suspension or the other because we dared to call the man Bob Say. But back to sports. At the Accra Stadium, we ran against Presec. Any Presecans here? I invited quite a number of Presecans that I knew they might not come because, you know, so I could do them talk, but the floor is ours. So now I said, you Presec? Yeah, it's a Presecan here. Mr. Sedo said, don't let anything in a dark blue vest overtake you. Dark blue vest. And I stood to that promise. I was running the third leg of the 4x400 meters race, and I was third in the flat, the 400 flat.
Clarence Amening, second in 400 meters, was to start the 4x400 meters, and our rivals were Presec. Clarence will be like second, and then me would maintain the second position, because in the calculation of our coach, I couldn't finish first. I shouldn't go behind. Just maintain. And then Prince Tete would take us to first and give to Washe, who will end the race first. Unknown to us, Clarence had malaria. So Clarence started, and I was happy that, oh, if he's second and I can maintain, I've done my part. He started well. And then around the 200 meters bend, he started slowing down because the malaria was having an effect. And I was waiting for the baton at the line. And Clarence dropped to third position. I said, Charlie, today trouble will catch me. Clarence dropped to fourth position. I had no see what I would do for the place. Clarence dropped to fifth position. And I knew that if there was to be any miracle that I needed in my life as a for lower sixth at the time, that was a miracle required. So Clarence handed the baton over when he was fifth. And the guy I was running against was a guy called Ayilongi. I reckon taller than Niteko, Akra Niteko. He was taller than Akra Niteko. They called him Ayilongi. He took over the baton, Presec. He was second or first. And I was fifth. And I ran the race of my life to defend the colors I proudly wear this evening. The zebra of Achimota School. Yeah, we call it zebra. Some people call it black and white, like the toffee, but this is zebra. So for fifth, and we just started going. I didn't run a calculated race. Those who have been at least, you know, first 100 meters fire, coast. No, it wasn't anything. Catch the thing in blue. Catch it. But since race were looking, catch that guy in the blue, catch him. So I was just going all out. And if I perish, I perish. Got to the final bend in second position. So we went closer and closer and closer. My brother, I remind you of your pain. I got to Ayilongi and then I came side by side like so. And an athlete, a serious athlete wouldn't do this, but I wasn't too serious an athlete at the time. I was more interested in what the guys do there, but I was also good at track and field. I just put on a trafficator line. I started doing like so, like this, like this, like this. And I passed Ayilongi and finished first position. Handed over to Prince T, who was to take us to first. He brought us back to second. But thankfully, we still ended the race, and we beat our nemesis at the time. We hadn't beaten them 4x4 for a very long time. That was the day I got about 3 scholarships. You know, scholarship. I was awarded scholarships, you know, by members of the fairer gender. Some people are wondering what scholarship. There's no school fees. There's no free school fees. No free SHS. I had to make a choice. I realized that the configuration of my head didn't matter. It was about the sports ability. I went and scraped the head, got a cheat because you couldn't keep your scalp. So I had to get a medical cheat. I need a cheat to cut my hair for the scalp to show I have a medical condition because it was genetic. But sports then defined me. Nobody remembered the 13-year-old back then, now 16, 17. Whether the hair went for it or not, I was school champion. 3 scholarships. And very well sought for by the guys. You're talking about comparative advantage versus unnecessary expenditure. And to be honest, when Accra chairman started, I was worried that he was about to read my speech. I would have thought he had done something like African electronics, which is a prison for some people from where I come. They like it a lot. They like electronics. We like electronics. Whether it works or not, it's neither here nor there. But in the various schools that we attended, I'm sure we derive pride from just wearing the colors of the school. We derive pride from going to the stadium, going to play soccer, hockey, track and field. Then basketball wasn't too popular. It's becoming more and more popular. And every time we went out, the Motown guys, where did they go? Presecans are going. Ogasco guys, Kwabuchi red and black. Amanfo yellow and green. And the colors were defined. These were sources of identity. And I decided I'll remain in sports. Because I found that if there's a thing called purpose, part of my purpose was in sports. And for those who follow sports in Ghana, you know I've been battered a little bit by some sports controversies. But if it's purpose, you will stay in it and still continue to rise anyway. We derive so much pride from the performance of the national team. So today, Happy FM called me in the morning and I expressed my lamentation about some Ghanaians who were jubilating when the Black Stars didn't qualify for the World Cup. Well, I don't know their perspective. But in discussing this subject, comparative advantage of nations, those of us who've traveled because of sports, we know what it means when the national team of your country does well. And I'll show a reel or some video of some countries and what they've defined as their sources of comparative advantage. Why it is that you see athletes from particular countries performing in certain specific disciplines all the time, consistently. They spend on sports. They invest in it, in its infrastructure, and in talent identification at a very early age. It's pathetic that in our country today, several schools or places that we call schools don't have playgrounds for the kids. They don't even have time to take them through some rudimentary exercises in sports. Sports built my confidence. I don't know what I would have done without sports. High comfy, self-acceptance. Locating yourself in society. That's what sports does for us. But today, playgrounds, absent. PE teachers, absent. In some schools, PE is taught on the blackboard because there's no field. How you practice, only God knows. I know some schools, they take the kids for PE once a month at the Awak Stadium. So if there's a child in there who is struggling with academics or the academic side and therefore it lacks confidence, when he gets on the sports field and excels, he gains confidence and says, if I can do sports so well, I can also do my academics very well. So for those of us who run educational institutions, let's just make sure that we have those facilities for the kids. It builds confidence. I know. Now I wear my hair very proudly. You know, I wear it. It's there. It's just that you don't see it, but it's there. I have a joke I say about it. You know, the Christians, they have this thing, they say the names of the Father. You know, this Jehovah, Jireh, Jehovah. What's that other one? Give me one. Niteko. Aloha Somo. Jehovah Rapha, which means the Lord my healer. Is it correct? Jehovah Shammah, is the Lord is present. Jehovah Shalom, the Lord is our peace. There are some of us in this audience, you cannot call him by the name some of us call him. Jehovah Baba. The Lord is my Baba. You cannot call him that name. But sports got us to accept it this way. Countries specialize in sports because they identify those sports as their sources of comparative advantage. I wish there was a tournament for Chaskele. You know, but Chaskele, I believe, was an ancient form of baseball and cricket. It's just that we didn't patent it early enough and internationalize it, so now we have to play cricket. But Chaskele is a sport. So what's comparative advantage for those who like some theory? I studied also chemistry, by the way. I studied chemistry in the University of Ghana. The course rocked me badly. After first degree, I knew I couldn't study science again. It was the end of my science trip. I went into people management and marketing and soccer. And by that, I began to identify myself in the community of nations. At a comparative advantage. So you become the only Ghanaian out of 17 FIFA marketing consultants responsible for 19 African countries. And whenever you go there, it's Ghana they see, comparative advantage. Comparative advantage is a concept in economics that a country should specialize in producing and exporting only those goods and services which it can produce more efficiently than other goods and services. There's a long stretch beyond there, but for me, that's the part that interests me. And my reference, so that I'll not be accused of plagiarism, is www.businessdictionary.com/definition/comparative advantage. From the work of UK economist David Ricardo, 1772 to 1823, in a piece he wrote entitled Comparative Cost, I have given due credit to who credit must be given. Sports used to be seen as recreation, but sports today is big business, multi-billion dollar business. So a young Kobolo, okay, not Kobolo, but a young guy called Asamwanjan, you know, he starts from very, very meager means and grows to become one of the wealthiest, if not the wealthiest, African footballer all time. $350,000 a week. If you are his agent, you take a minimum of 10%, $35,000 a week. Multiplied by 50 weeks, take two dash some people. You're looking at $1.75 million for the agent, not the player. Multiplied by 10, that's the player's annual earnings. Comparative advantage. And several of them, Michael Essien. You can talk of boxing. Watch a reel that reminds us of the mid-80s. I'll talk about him soon. But these are sources of our comparative advantage. And for those who talk about unnecessary expenditure, I'm sure it's because sometimes it looks so much. So we can't do a cost-benefit analysis and say this is worthy of our spend or not. It's understandable. But I hold to the view that if we spend strategically, it's worth every cedi we spend. I was in Germany in 2006 with the Black Stars. After the sponsorship was broken, the guy said, Neil, come and manage the sponsorship. What was nicer than doing something you enjoy doing, sit in the stadiums of Germany, go and shout and shijama. And then every day they are paying you like 1,000 euro, a crutch chairman, 1,000 euro per day. It's called per diem. I was there for 42 days. Oh my goodness. Chemistry did not do this for me. Had the Black Stars not qualified, would I have been there? No. Would Ghanaians have been proud? No. The German police slackened their rigor when we were passing through from Germany to England to go and visit family. Because we are beating Czech Republic 2-0. So we won Ghana colors. Ghana, good team, good team. Go. Comparative advantage. So those who are celebrating when we didn't qualify because of a certain notion of excessive spending, but those of us who work in football, you know that there are challenges with everything in this country, yes. And we can work at those challenges, but for God's sake, we can't celebrate when our nation doesn't do well. It's not right. Personal opinion. This is our only nation. We don't have any other nation. We celebrate our nation. We are proud of the nation. Sports gives us a sense of identity, sense of pride. You go to the UAE, they mention Mohamed Polo. He did wonders there. They mention Abedi Pele. You go to France, they mention Michael Essien. You go to the States, they mention Azuma Nelson. Lion of Africa. That is comparative advantage. Money spent, yes. But it gives us that source of pride and energy to continue investing in it. In every basketball Olympic Games semifinal, you would find an American team. Typically, rarely do they miss out, even on the final. Long distance running, you will see the Kenyans. Kenyan first, Kenyan second, Kenyan third. Sprint, you see Bolt first, Asafa Power second, Nesta Carter challenging with Justin Gatlin. Michael Johnson, 200 final meters champion, 19 years a record stood till the Jamaican came there. So if it's not an American, it would be a Jamaican for the sprints, holding the world record. That is comparative advantage. How many times do you hear them excelling at long distance? Rarely, occasionally, somebody will pass through. One of them won the Chicago Marathon a few days ago, American route. But it is a rare occurrence. Second to win it in like 70 years. The thing is being run in America. American won the second time in like 70 years. Because it's not their comparative advantage. Chinese dominating gymnastics. Don't they? See the brother table, Jin Kwan Kong first, Chong Chin Mi three, Sun Kwan Kok three. First, second, third. The same with Kenyans, Mark Chiprotich two, Philip Kwech second. And another Kiprotich brother or cousin will be the third. Where does Ghana appear in these international sports occasions? Where we have typically appeared, more often than not, is where? Soccer and boxing. True or false? And that's why I'm so passionate when people try to downplay what we do. We'll watch a 7 or 4 minute video depicting some of the things I just described about some of these nations. And then we'll pause briefly. I'll speak a little bit about Ghana's side, and we'll watch a little bit about Ghana. And I'm working within a time frame of 35 to 40 minutes. You know, sports guys, we stick to time. If there's a need, you ask for time added on for interference. Like when the guys came and were playing with my microphone, you may ask for time added on. You do yellow card. All right, so let's watch some Jamaicans and Americans. If the sound doesn't come around commentary, it wouldn't be the first time. All right, so that's a 4x100 meters final. You'll be watching us for certain nationalities.
Fascinating with four men in it at the bell. Tembo has just been passed by Taha. Taha, the ex-Kenyan. So isn't finished yet. He seems he's come back a bit. Retire back off the pace in seven. They now come towards the finish. It's a familiar figure.
That's the now he's looked around to check out his compatriot, but he's got a cool run now to the last hurdle.
And Kipruto takes that last hurdle. He's going away from Kemboi. It's going to be Kenya success once again. It's Kenya 1, Kenya 2, Kenya 3.
We take you back once again, flipping through the face.
So there was a Kenya 1, 2, 3. Was there?
with the attention of the entire nation focused on a diminutive young Gamboy far away in a foreign land. We were in Agri-House at the time. We managed to sneak into one of the master's houses. I will not mention his name because there might be retroactive retribution. So I won't mention the name of the master, but we got a black and white TV, also called Miawenishwe. You guys came here watching TV on phones. Sometimes you need to go back in time. You know, there were boxes. You carry them, you'd be macho. And in the box room in Agri-House, we watched this diminutive young Ghanaian. We watched the Black Stars in 82, Libya. The last time we won the African Nations Cup, 1982. I like to remember these things. That was a source of national pride. I watched the satellites of 2009. Let's watch them. Comparative advantage. And then we'll discuss where we should be going as a nation if we want to maintain those levels of comparative advantage. So 1982 in Libya.
Pages of our history books to Tripoli, 1982, a familiar figure there, as in Libya the final saw Ghana on their way to one of the four victories that they have recorded in this tournament history. Ghana in the white here against host nation Libya. It was 1-1 at the end of the 90 minutes. Goal for Ghana in the first half from Al Hassan, and then when defenders failed to clear, it's Libya with an equaliser on 70 minutes. Beshari, the scorer, that's what they thought of things inside the stadium, and it went to penalties. And a really nerve-wracking sequence it was as well before Ghana won 7-6.
Effort by Raphael. Still in the first half, defender Daniel Ogo sent off 37 minutes in. Ghana would play the remainder of the match with 10 men against a tough Brazilian side. But Brazil couldn't capitalize in the second half, and after 90 scoreless minutes, they would go to extra time. Maicon with a chance saved twice by Adjei in the 95th minute and the 112th minute. This a later effort, as Maicon would end up one-on-one with the keeper again. Good reaction by the Ghanaian. Scoreless through extra time, the title would be decided from the spot. Both sides converted three of the first five penalty kicks, but then Adjei saves from Tejeda, and in steps Agyemang Badu, a chance for the game winner, and he converts. Third time's the charm for Ghana, win the nation's first under 20 World Cup title, after finishing second in.
When I get older, I will be stronger. They'll call me freedom, just like a waving flag.
When I get older, I will be stronger. They'll call me freedom, just like a waving flag. And then it goes back, and they have known where I got grown. Streets we would roam, out of the darkness. I came the farthest, among the hardest survivors. Accept no defeat, surrender, retreat.
We'll be struggling,
fighting to eat,
and we wondering
when we'll be free.
So we patiently wait for that fateful day. It's not far away, but for now we say,
when I get older, I will be stronger. They'll call me freedom, just like a waving flag. And then it going back, and then it going back, and then it going back.
This was the night I was referring to in Agri-House.
Well, the left hand connected on Nelson, trying to nail him. Good play.
The fighter's been shaken here.
Right hand by Nelson. Overhand right. It was a slapping punch, but it seemed to...
If you come from San Paco, you see Mali.
He found a home. Nelson has... Wilfredo continues to go backwards in this fight. Surprising maneuver on his part.
Nelson is clearly the aggressor.
Gomez. Oh, the left hand. And a big right hand by Azuma Nelson.
That hurt him.
Gomez's punches are now much more fighting earlier.
Oh, good right by.
Good overhand right, but once again not having any significant effect on Azuma Nelson. Decisions, but even though Nelson is landing big shots,
time to time. Maintain his title. He's been hit with some good shots by Gomez.
Oh, he's stunned! Gomez is stunned! Gomez trying desperately to hang on. A right hand by Nelson. Another right hand. Right hand. Nelson with a left in the corner just overhead. Now survival time for Gomez, and against those ropes, he's a target. Oh, and a right hand. Another right hand. Azuma Nelson. Oh, over Sanchez. That would give Gomez a chance to rest, but he's not doing it.
Wilfredo Gomez, a bloody mouth now. And the mouse over the right eye is getting larger.
What a left hook by Nelson. Gomez nearly out on his feet.
He's down.
He's down.
Azuma Nelson is
out again. Wilfredo Gomez is out. That is the end of the fight. The fight is over. That is it. Azuma Nelson has knocked out Wilfredo Gomez in the 11th round. Azuma Nelson has become only the sixth African in history to become a champion.
Azuma Nelson obtiene el cetro pluma del Consejo Mundial de Boxeo. Puerto Rico saluda a Ghana. Puerto Rico saluda a Ghana.
If you ask me to translate what the lady was saying, I promise you I wouldn't be able to say anything sensible. But watching those pictures again take us so far back into those periods in our nation's life where we were proud. And I watch them all the time just to encourage ourselves that we've been there before, we can be there again. It's about what do we want to do with our sports? Where does sports fit in the national life? I mean, where is it? If we saw Ghana as a company called Ghana Incorporated, and in every company where it is a company that's set up for profit, you've got cash cows, the products that, or the brands that bring you money, that help you to take care of the brands that don't give you money. Where do we place our sports? What does sports mean to us? Is it recreation? Is it a place where we decide we should fight? Or is it a place that brings us together? And if you follow our sports, every time our national teams or athletes have performed, we all coalesce together as a people. Sports doesn't divide. And that's why I'm strongly against it. When a political dispensation comes and says, we want this and those want what? You want what? Did you play some of the football? Did you enter that ring and get beat like somebody was beating a sword while I go up there? Providence put you where you were. Maybe some strategic calculation in politics put you where you were. But the talent is Ghanaian. The talent is not elephantine, or it's not covered by an umbrella. Neither does it follow a red cockerel. The talent is GH, one Ghana. And we resist it all the time. Sometimes successfully, other times not quite successfully. But sports binds us together as a people. And for me, that's the reason why sports is a source of our comparative advantage. So many other things divide us. Sports doesn't. So apart from soccer and boxing, we play hockey in Motown also. Some swam successfully, others not quite so successfully. The swimming pool is there. For some of us, the swimming pool was where we do, breath training. You know, we go under the water and count how many seconds we can be there to develop, you know, the breathing capacity. I wasn't too good at swimming. You can't be good at everything. I learned how to swim later because I didn't want to be in a situation where the river will be flowing and I cannot even swim with the tide, let alone against the tide. For my grand brethren to be around and start singing a song for me, Falekele, yae, Falekele. But what is to show that for a country that has water bodies dotted all around, all within us, and the coastline from Aflao to Axim, we can't get world champion swimmers
What's to show we can't? See how the guys, they swim in the sea. It might not be the same skill in the swimming pool, but I dare say if you can beat the waves, you should be able to beat the ripples of the swimming pool. What's to show? Have we looked at it strategically? I mean, my call is to look at sports as part of our strategic intent as a people. That is when sports becomes a source of comparative advantage and not unnecessary expenditure. So that we don't say because everybody is doing some discipline, and I have nothing against other sporting disciplines. But the truth of the matter is, every people, every nation is endowed with certain specific morphological, biological or morphological. For later, you come and explain the better one for me because the chemistry was a problem. Sorry, the chemistry was a problem. But our morphology, the way we are constructed, gives us certain source of comparative advantage. Where every little boy in living in some area plays gutter to gutter. So we are very skillful. We don't shoot well. So if we look at it strategically, right from the beginning, instead of encouraging the gutter to gutter, as they play the gutter to gutter, expand the field small, shoot better. We have what it takes to win the FIFA World Cup. No stress. Brazil 2014, all the controversy. We drew with Germany, the eventual winners. We should have even beaten them easily. So $3 million flew in the air. And all the nice things that the guys did vanished. A lot of times, we say we can't do it because of the no money syndrome. But if you think about it strategically, money is not an issue. It's the idea that sports is a source of comparative advantage. It will compel corporate Ghana to get involved. And we sports guys ourselves, how well do we even brand ourselves? So the talent is there. Comparative advantage, export, Asajan, all the guys I mentioned, Azuma, Micah Hay, all these guys from time past, we export them. They go and make good money out there and repatriate it back there. Evidence, there's a sports stadium called Asamoah Sports Complex at Accra Academy. Example. It's there. If you didn't know, Google it. You will see it. I said Google. I didn't say Google. So is there a cost to strategically invest in the development of our sports as a nation? I say yes. But it's strategic investment. If we invest strategically in our sports, it becomes that source of comparative advantage. And we walk around the cities of this world with our shoulders held high. You know, walking, yeah, I enter the place, they say, oh, you're from Ghana? Oh, Abedi Pele, Samuajan. I know play the boss. He played the soccer, I take the glory. Azuma takes the beating, we take the glory. We cannot call it unnecessary expenditure. We are endowed with so much talent as a people, Ghanaians and Achimotans. It's for us to look at this thing strategically and say, having done a strategic analysis of all the regions of this country, the Bronga Hafu have people with more brawn. Let's put them in some maybe wrestling or arm wrestling something. The guys with the height all towards the north, with exceptions in the south, let's put them in basketball. The hills of the eastern region and the Volta region, let them contest with the Kenyans for long distance running. The coastal dwellers, my brethren from Aflau, all the way through Ghana to Central Region Cape Coast. Instead of only catching fish, develop some swimmers. So I end by saying these things. Let us as Achimotans and Ghanaians continue to play the games that give Ghana a source of comparative advantage. Because I believe it is a source of comparative advantage. Never unnecessary expenditure. Let us ensure that our sporting success inspires the nation of this world to continue to shout the name of Ghana. Just as the continent of Africa, during South Africa 2010 World Cup, were calling our national team, not the Black Stars of Ghana. They called us in SA, the Black Stars of Africa. And by so doing, they spread our fame afar. Achimotans and Ghanaians, may our strategic investment in Ghana sports ensure that Ghana assumes and maintains the position of head of all the hosts, that nation of whom we boast, and the glory of this well-endowed country on the west coast of Africa. May God indeed bless our homeland, Ghana. I thank you very much for your kind attention and wish us all a wonderful evening.